भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्यां नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जायामुदीरहे नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीरुत्तमा श्लोके भक्तिर्भवती नैष्ठिकी कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 11 चैप्टर 13 टेक्स्ट 27 जाग्रत स्वप्नः सुषुप्तम् च गुणातो बुद्धिवृत्तया तासं वैलक्षणो जीवः साक्षित्वेन विनिश्चिता। जाग्रत स्वप्न सुसुप्तम् च गुणातो बुद्धिवृत्तया तासं विलक्षणो जीवा साक्षित्वेन विनिश्चिता। जाग्रस्वप्न सुसुप्तम् च गुणातो बुद्धिवृत्तया तासं विलक्षणो जीवा साक्षित्वेन विनिश्चिता। जाग्रस्वप्न सुसुप्तम् च गुणातो बुद्धिवृत्तया तासं विलक्षणो जीवा साक्षित्वेन विनिश्चिता। जाग्रत बीइंग अवेक स्वप्न ड्रीमिंग सुसुप्तम डीप स्लीप च ऑल्सो गुणातः कॉज्ड बाय द मोड्स ऑफ नेचर बुद्धि ऑफ इंटेलिजेंस वृत्तया द फंक्शंस तासम फ्रॉम सच फंक्शंस विलक्षणः पोजेसिंग डिफरेंट कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स जीव द लिविंग एंटिटी साक्षित्वेन विद द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ बीइंग अ विटनेस Vinishchitah is ascertained. Translation: waking, sleeping, and deep sleep are the three functions of the intelligence and are caused by the modes of material nature. The living entity within the body is ascertained to possess characteristics different from these three states, and thus remain as a witness to them. Purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada. The spirit soul actually has nothing to do with the material world, having no permanent or natural relationship with it. I repeat, the spirit soul actually has nothing to do with the material world. These two words are important. Having no permanent or natural relationship with it. Real renunciation means to give up the illusory identification with matter in its subtle and gross forms. Susuptam or deep sleep indicates sleeping without any dreams or conscious activity. These three states are described by Lord Krishna as follows: Satvaj Jagranam Vidyad, Rajasa Swapanam Adishet, Prashvanam Prashvapsa Tamasa Jatos, Turyanam Trishu Satatam. One should know that wakefulness is born of mode of goodness, dreams from the mode of passion, and deep dreamless sleep from the mode of ignorance. The fourth element, pure consciousness, is different from these three and pervades them. Bhagavatam 11.25.20. Real freedom means shakshitvena, or to exist as a witness to the functions of illusion. Such an advantageous position is achieved by the development of Krishna consciousness. Om Gyan Timirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prestaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine. Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namine Gauratvishe Namaha. Panchatvatvatmakam Krishnam Bhakta Rupa Swarupakam Bhakta Avataram Bhaktakyam Namami Bhakta Shaktikam. He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute. Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Brindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye. Jayashi Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivas Adi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So this is by great fortune both for myself and all of us together. We are getting exposed to some of the most deep profound knowledge that can exist in any creation. As we really go deep into this beautiful scripture, sometimes it is very, very sweet with beautiful pastimes, and sometimes it is very, very deeply technical. But that's what is the recipe for all of us to really get rid of this Bhava Rog. It's a disease, so there is a formula. So Bhagavatam is the best medicine. And today we see here, at least I was extremely more than ever, just to see the profoundness of the knowledge that is there in the script, in our scriptures. And the background is very, very interesting. In the eighth verse, I'm sure all of you have attended it, but just to get a context, in the eighth verse, this is, as we know, this is the conversation between Uddhava and Krishna, the Uddhava Gita, very, very interesting. And Krishna is personally replying to Uddhava, just like he replied to Arjun, but much, much more deeper inquiries and much more deeper replies. So Uddhava is asking in the eighth verse, "My dear Krishna, generally human beings know that material life brings great future unhappiness, and still they try to enjoy material life. My dear Lord, how can one in knowledge act just like a dog, an ass or a goat?" So this is the inquiry which is making, and I'm sure all of us understand that this is very much relevant to all of us. I mean, we are in the 11th canto of Bhagavad. We have obviously finished the 10th canto of Bhagavad. So we have gone to the most cream part of the Bhagavatam. But again, we come back to the basics. And here are the two most powerful personalities having dialogue. When two or more very important personalities have dialogue, the churned knowledge is something very, very important to understand. So Uddhava is one of the closest friends of Krishna. He has spent years and years and years of intense Krishna bhakti. He has obviously seen the deep devotion of the gopis of Vrindavan. Krishna also has, I mean, finished his Vrindavan pastimes, Dwarka pastimes. He's asking the basic thing again for all of us, that in general human beings know their material life is going to be greatly unhappiness in the future. And then the Lord answers in verse number 14, "The actual yoga system as taught by my devotee headed by Sanak Kumar is simply this. Having withdrawn the mind from all objects, one should directly and appropriately absorb in me." The same knowledge of the Gita, repeating again. Absorb in Krishna. So it is interesting that Krishna is, Lord Krishna is quoting his own devotee here. Obviously, he has given the knowledge to Sanat Kumar. He didn't say, "Well, I spoke this knowledge," but he's quoting Sanat Kumar. This is another very interesting aspect of what it means to really give the due credit to where it is due. Krishna is saying that, "Well, as quoted by my devotee Sanat Kumar," he's saying this. Many times, you know, we have this habit of stealing ideas, stealing words, stealing statements. Just many years back, you know, we went to a place, I don't want to name it because it's out of the country. And a group of devotees here had worked very hard for years to come up with a manual, a Grihastha manual. A lot of effort was made. And of course, then the whole idea is to distribute the manual everywhere. Whoever wants to use it was using it. So we went to this one place, and somebody said, you know, we also have our Grihastha manual. I said, oh, very nice. It was in that local language. So I asked the local devotee, can you just please tell me what are the headlines, the topics? Because I was involved in that committee while I was here to make this Grihastha manual. So as we went through the main topics, it was exactly the same manual that we made. But what was written behind? The local devotees' names. You get the thing, but put your name on it. Now, it, of course, the knowledge is knowledge doesn't belong to anybody. Knowledge belongs to Krishna. It's nobody can claim proprietorship over knowledge, because Vedesa Sarvam Aham Eva Vedyo Vedanta Krit Veda Videha Chaham. The Krishna is the source of all knowledge. So it's not anybody proprietor, but just this whole, it's a small thing. But when I learned this, it became just so very difficult for me to really have put trust in anybody there after that. I was trying, I said it's just a group of devotees who did this, everybody else will not be like that. But I'm giving a small example of how the important aspect of taking somebody's quote or taking somebody's knowledge, taking somebody's and giving it due credit, it's a very, very important act of being trusting and trustworthy. If you trust that person, and then you become trustworthy also. So Krishna is also very wonderfully saying, as spoken by Sanakumar. A small thing, but I found it very interesting. Now Krishna can claim it, and he is the only person who can rightfully claim all knowledge to be his. As I spoke and Krishna spoke, and everything that is there is what Krishna has spoken. But Bhagavatam teaches this small, very minute points, which is very, very, it gives a lot of nourishment and gives a much more deeper understanding. So anyway, the Lord is quoting his devotee. He's saying that, well, one should withdraw his mind from objects and should directly and appropriately absorb in me. And similarly, Uddhava is saying, oh, you addressed to Sanat Kumar? When was it? What did you speak? Please tell me something more. And then comes a very interesting part. And then Krishna gives the reference to context. He gives a reference that originally the Kumaras asked this question, which is 27, which is why I'm reading these verses, is because it is so very relevant that these things are asked by such great personalities. The great sages headed by Sanaka asked, O Lord, now when you say O Lord here, they're asking to Lord Brahma, his father, their father. O Lord, people's minds are naturally attracted to material sense objects, and similarly the sense objects in the form of desires enter within the mind. Therefore, how can a person who desires liberation, who desires to cross over the activities of sense gratification, destroy this mutual relationship between the sense object and mind? Please explain this to me. Very interesting. Mutual relationship between sense object and the mind. Isn't that a wonderful thing? It is. We all are having an intense mutual relationship since time immemorial. Krishna bhuliya jiva bhogavancha kare nikatya mayasthane jhapatya dhare. That Krishna bhuliya jiva, after, since we have forgotten Krishna since time immemorial, jiva bhogavancha kare. We are constantly hankering for sense gratification. Now I'm sure this was a statement we all heard in the first few days of our Krishna consciousness, this word sense gratification. It is still coming, and it will keep on coming. Sense gratification. And what I found interesting is the mutual relationship that the Kumaras are asking to Lord Brahma. So that how can we get rid of this mutual relationship? Because it is just a natural affinity that the mind has for the sense gratification objects.
Just like there is a natural affinity for, you know, for a thirsty person to run towards water. It's just so natural. When he sees water, he drinks water because there's affinity. There's an acute deficiency in him. And that's why he gets drawn to something which will take care of that deficiency. That's why small children, why do you think they start eating dirt? I mean, we have the famous story, Krishna eating dirt. But small children eat dirt, why? Because there's a natural, from the scientific perspective, from the medical perspective, there's a lack of calcium and other things in their body, and naturally the mind is demanding that you can get calcium from the sand and everything, so you eat it and then they eat it. So that's why when you go to a doctor, you will wonder that how can a medicine cure the person not to eat dirt? There is medicines. Because I know it because I was doing it. I used to eat a lot of dirt. I used to just take and it was so nice. And then they gave me a medicine. And then when I grew up, I said, how can a medicine help somebody not eat dirt? But it's just that because there is acute deficiency of something in the body, the body is demanding to do something else and you do that. Similarly, there's an acute deficiency to enjoy, there's a need to enjoy by the mind. And because the sense object gives that enjoyment, you are naturally drawn to. That's why there is a mutual relationship. This question was asked to Lord Brahma. Lord Brahma, we have bodies which made up of five elements. What is his body made up of? Lord Brahma. Intelligence. He's all made about, can you imagine his body is intelligence? Is made up of intelligence. And then what is explained? In the 18th verse, this is so interesting. My dear Uddhava, Brahma himself was born directly from the body of Lord, who is the creator of all living entities within the material world, being the best of demigods, seriously contemplated the question of his sons headed by Sanaka. The intelligence of Brahma, however, was affected by his own activities of creation, and thus he could not discover the essential answers to these questions. So when somebody asks us, first let us contemplate. Many a times, we are just ready with a reply before the question is asked, because we are so eager to reply and show that, well, we know many times. But as we have said in Hindi, jo bhi hum bolte hum tol mol ke, whatever you speak should be measured. Should be measured properly. And their measurement is all about contemplation. Speech, the austerities of speech is to have contemplative speech and not demonstrative speech. Many times we just demonstrate through our speech something without any contemplation, without any substance within. So most of our speech is demonstrative. It's just a demo of something. But there's no contemplation, there's no depth in our speech. Lord Brahma went deep and said, Lord Brahma is made of intelligence, he can just speak. But he contemplated and then he realized, I can't answer this. So what does this show? I was so impressed with this whole understanding that this question, which appears to be such a simple question, when Lord Brahma contemplated, he said, I don't have an answer for this. Because he himself is involved, as explained. The intelligence of Brahma, however, was affected by his own activities of creation. Sometimes when we do activities, and what we call in our ISKCON society, seva, the seva can make us very much get involved in it. The seva can give rise to tremendous amount of passion. And when you are passionate, you cannot really think properly. So please understand, our own seva, our own activities can bind us. It depends upon in what mode you do your seva. The seva for the sake of achievement is intensely passionate, and we may not give the right result. The seva without really being attached to doing it just in a very carefree way to do it, or not even doing the seva, is obviously in the mode of ignorance. But the seva, to do the right seva in the right way, at the right time, with the right people, is obviously in the mode of goodness. But the seva we do without any attachment for anything in return is obviously seva in a pure of mode of pure goodness. But many times, if it can happen to Lord Brahma, I think let's not be, in any way, shape or form under illusion that it cannot happen to us. The seva can, and I will use the word, does bind us. We get bewildered by our own seva. Many, many years back, I was discussing with His Holiness Sachinandan Swami Maharaj. And of course, he gave me a very graphical description of how our own service, because if it is devotional service, it doesn't bind. He said it. But our own service, which obviously not done in a completely devotional way, can bind. And he said, just like devotional service is a powerful weapon to really shoot the negative material energy. It's like a weapon you shoot. So whenever somebody has a weapon, the other person gets scared, right? If you say, hands up, and then you get scared. Yes, hands up. So devotional service is a powerful weapon given by Lord Krishna and by our spiritual master Srila Prabhupada as a weapon to really shoot the material energy. But the material energy is very, very subtle, as Sachinanda Swami was explaining. And he said that you are shooting the gun, and once or twice you shoot and you feel successful. Yes, I achieved it. Yeah, come on, that's good. Come on. You got the bullseye. And what happens then, he said? And he said, my dear Sridhama Das, your gun is now slowly, slowly been handled by Maya, and she just turns the nozzle towards you. He was explaining. You are not aware of this. You still have the gun. She shifts the nozzle. And then you shoot. And every time you shoot, you are getting shot. Why? Because that's the bewildering factor of the service that we can do. And let us all deeply contemplate this particular portion of Lord Brahma. That he said, I can't answer it because I'm not in that mode to really reply. That's why he called for Lord Krishna, Krishna, and then Krishna came as the Hamsa avatar, and that's why he's speaking what he's speaking just now. So this whole aspect of sense gratification, material energy, maya, is something which is very, very important for all of us to understand. And in this verse, it's been explained very, very nicely about the three stages: wakeful, dream, and deep dreamless sleep. So I was telling some of my friends outside, the brahmachari friends, I said, and all of you are going to have nice sleep today, because obviously first reason is because I'm going to be speaking not much interesting, and second reason is there's a lot of discussion on sleep today. So we are going to discuss about sleep. How many of you feel that sleep is very, very important? All of us. I'm sure we all know what's going to happen after the class is over for many of us. There are many, many interesting facts I was studying about sleep. And I said, few things to share with you, that a human being on an average spends 1/3 of his life sleeping. 1/3 of his life, a human being on an average sleeps. I said, sleep deprivation can kill you more quickly than food deprivation. So if you are sleep deprived, it can kill you faster than food. Many of us feel food is most important, man. without food I will die. But no, my dear friend, from this statement, from this analysis, from this study, from this, by the scientists, is explained that sleep deprivation is more dangerous than food deprivation. It can kill you faster. And one day you don't, you deprive yourself of sleep, I think all devotees should need to know this. We are so we're feeling we don't intoxicate, you know, we don't take intoxication. Yeah. But the scientists prove that one day of sleep deprivation can make you more disturbed, your brain gets more disturbed than an adequate quantity of intoxication. The mind is more disturbed. When you take intoxication, the mind is disturbed. But if you are sleep deprived, it is much more disturbed than taking a huge quantity of intoxication. Sleep deprivation. So the sleep is something which is, it is explained that the maximum a person has survived without sleeping is 11 days. And on the 12th day, he died. And we know people who have not eaten for 50 days, 100 days, 108 days, 150 days, or maybe for years. But a person, if he doesn't sleep, that's why you can understand how glorious is Arjun, whose name is Gudakesh. We have conquered over sleep. Please understand, this sleep is something which is, in the most, easiest of situations, you can control your hunger, but when sleep comes, it's beyond you, right? It's just absolutely beyond you. That's why we have hilarious stories about sleep in our Hare Krishna movement. Because the fact is, we are really sleep deprived bunch of people here. We are, if you don't really take care of the proper, we are really sleep deprived. So here, we can understand, just by the way, we talked about little about sleep, but here we're talking about three stages that we all, the awake stage, the dream stage, and the deep sleepless, dreamless sleep stage. So let us briefly discuss this very technical understanding, which is very interesting to understand. What exactly is the Lord trying to say? What exactly we need to do is explaining that when you awake, you are in a mode of goodness in the verse which is quoted, that is the 11th canto, 25th verse, 25th chapter, 22 verse. He said that when you are awake, you are in the mode of goodness. When you are in a dream state, is in the mode of passion. And where you are in a deep sleep stage, in a mode of ignorance. And then the fourth stage is explained, the Turiya stage, which is beyond this stage, which is known as the word is described here, the stage of being a witness. Sakshitvena, the word is emphasized here. Sakshitvena is the stage of being a witness. So let us understand this. Just imagine that there is a screen. And on the screen, there are so many images. A movie is going on, and the screen has so many images thrown on it. Sometimes there's an image of a huge forest fire. Yeah? And sometimes there's an image of unending ocean. It's just thrown on it. And for a person who is viewing it, it could be real. But for the screen, as far as the screen is concerned, does the screen get wet because of the ocean water on an image of ocean thrown on it? Does the screen get burnt because of the forest fire? The screen is not affected in any way, shape or form. Right? So what is explained here is that we are most of the time in the dream state. Now what is this dream state about? Now in a dream state, is explained that you will be, you know, when you're walking and you're walking and you see a rope, and you feel that the rope is not a rope but it is a snake. So what is happening is that while you imagine the rope is a snake, you cannot see the rope as a rope, is it not? the mind has imagined something that this is a snake. So the non-existent snake becomes real to you while the real rope seems completely non-existent to you. Are you with me? Right? So what, when you see the rope out there and you say this is a snake, so the mind, please understand, is the mind which is saying this is not a rope, it is a snake. So the non-existent snake becomes real and the reality of the rope is not there because your mind has convinced you this is not a rope, this is a snake. So in other words, dream is nothing but the doubt of reality. What is a dream state? That you are thinking something which is not true. So imagine you are dreaming, and in the dream, I'm sure all of us dream. That dream is real, isn't it? Yes. And you know, many times we experience that it's really absolutely real. But either we get a nightmare, then we are relieved that we are no more in that dream, or we have a sweet dream and we feel disgusted because of coming out of that sweet dream. And when we come out, we realize that this is not real. This is not real. Similarly, my dear friends, the state that we're talking about is a dreaming state when we see that the material energy is something that which is not. We are constantly dreaming. Just like we are convinced that this rope is a snake when the actually what exists is a rope. Similarly, what exists is nothing but material sense gratification. But when we see it as something which is not true, which means that this is going to give me pleasure, then there is this mutual relationship between the sense object and the mind, as explained in the previous verse. And that's what keeps us constantly in the dream stage, which is nothing but a stage of passion. And as explained in the previous verses, till the time we are not in the mode of goodness, we cannot really make progress in Krishna consciousness. We have to be in the mode of goodness to really go to the next stage. So the unfortunate thing is, the majority of time, people are constantly spending their time in the dream stage to think something which is not, and that's exactly what we call Maya. And that is why we have this beautiful bhajans, Jeev Jago Gaur Chandra Bole. Why suddenly is Bhaktivinoda Thakur in this Arunodaya Kirtan talking about waking up sleeping souls? Why is the analogy used of waking up? Because it is a deep understanding that we learn from this verses what exactly sleeping is all about. Because in the sleep we dream, in that dream stage we feel something which is not true, and that is completely contrary to our making progress in Krishna consciousness. I know it sounds technical, but we have to understand this technicalities to really see the world the way it is. We have to be like the screen. The fourth situation, as explained, just a witness. What's a witness? A Sakshitvena is specifically emphasized in this purport. Sakshitvena, as a witness. Let us analyze what actually witness is. Sometimes, you know, there is a transaction, or there is somebody's marriage or some business deal or something, and the people sign, and then there is a witness. That I'm a witness. My Lord Krishna and Radharani also got married in Bandiravan. Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, they are witness that yes, we saw this marriage. So what does witness mean? Witness means they are not part of the transaction, but they are observing it as an observer. Please understand, witness is not part of the transaction. The problem is, we, when it comes to material energy, we are constantly part of a transaction with the material energy. We transact energy. We transact There's some exchange that happens, and because we are constantly part, we can never be the witness. And because we can never be the witness, we get deluded and bombarded constantly by the material energy, because we transact energy with the material energy. There's exchange which happens here. Right? So the world is, so we cannot deny that the world is reality, but it's a dream. It's a dream that we are thinking that it's a reality. So that's why we must all come and understand, we must all understand that we need to come out of this dream stage. That is why it explained, Udila Aruna Purabha Bhage Dvija Mani Gaura Amani Jage Bhakata Samuha Loilo Sate Gila Najara Raja. So it is explained beautifully, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, that it is, just imagine this scene, that in the beautiful horizon of Gaura Desh, Udilo Aruna, when the sun is just rising, and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is going, and what is saying? Udilo Aruna Purabha Bhage Dvija Mani Gaura Amani Jage Bhakata Samuha Loilo Sate Gila Najara Raja. What is saying? Tatai Tatai Bhajala Khola Ghana Ghana Tane Janjara Rol Preme dhala dhala sonara anga charan nupur baje. And then comes the, he said, Mukunda Madhava Yadava Hari Bolena Bolore Badana Bhari Miche Nindra Boshe Gelore Rati. Very interesting again. The Miche Nindra Boshe Gelore Rati Jivas Sarira Saje, that you have spent your whole night simply sleeping. You have just used that time in being in complete mode of ignorance or mode of passion. And that's why he's saying, Mukunda Madhava Yadava Hari. That's why you chant the names of Mukunda, Madhava, Yadava and Hari. And then he says, Emona Durlaba Manava Deho. That you have got this very rare human form of life. Pai Aki Kero Bhavana Geho Ebena Bhajila Yashoda Sutta Charana Pobila Laje. That you have got this rare form of life. So please serve the darling of Yashoda. Please wake up to the reality. And what is the reality? The reality is Krishna. There's nothing else. What is that verse? Ekala Ishwara Krishna Ara Sakala Bhritya. Now, you know, if we could really understand all these verses that we so often quote, I mean, we could be really, really, you know, advanced in our understanding. Ekala Ishwara Krishna. Nothing else. There's only one truth, that is Krishna. Our sakala, everything else is bhritya, is false, is illusion, is dream. That's why he's telling us to chant the holy names. And then he says, the sun rises and sets, and the day is lost, and we remain idle, not serving the Lord in our heart. So why is Bhaktivinoda Thakur, you know, writing all these bhajans? Why is he writing this aspect of waking up? Till the time you don't wake up to the truth. And in this context, we have very interesting understanding from the story of Maharaj Muchukunda. Maharaj Muchukund, we all know, we are not going to tell the whole story, but Maharaj Muchukund was he got some very special service with the demigods. He was fighting for years and years and years in a different time zone. And then of course he was so tired, there's a huge time has lapsed, all his family members were all gone many years back. Then he was so tired, he said, I want to sleep. And he was completely sleeping in a cave. And so sometimes the heart is also be compared to be like guha or cave. The heart is like a cave. And Muchukunda was sleeping in that cave. And then of course Krishna came. That's why Krishna, or Krishna from the holy name that comes in our heart, Krishna came. And he just simply illuminated the whole cave by his presence. Just like knowledge illuminates us. And what's the knowledge? The knowledge is, let us not be in the Sushupta stage. Let us not be in the Swapna stage. Let us be in the Jagrat stage. Let us be awake to the reality. That's knowledge. Krishna Surya Sama Maya Hoy Andhakar Jahan Krishna Tahan Nahi Maya Radhikar. So when Muchukunda saw that, but he had to destroy Kalyavan before he really had association of Krishna. So to destroy all the negative energy, and when Krishna comes, the light comes, the knowledge destroys everything which is negative, like Kalyavan, and then what we see is pure light. So similarly, we all need to be completely awake. But the process which is supposed to awaken us, many times we get more and more in a sleepy stage in this process. And the process is supposed to awaken us, right? We are supposed to, every time you hear some scripture with some knowledge, we should be waking up to the reality. But the tendency of going to sleep is so intense that after you awake also, you go to sleep again. Right? Just the tendency to sleep is so intense. And what is a sleep state? It's nothing but the desire to associate with material energy again. And I was thinking that the four basic pillars of sense gratification, that is so clearly explained to us, no meat eating, no gambling, no intoxication, no illicit sex. We all have taken vows, serious lifelong vows, for those who are initiated, to not engage in this sense gratificatory activities, a form of no meat eating, no intoxicating, no gambling, no illicit sex. And I'm sure a very honest devotee will never really do this ever after he takes this vow. He said you should be ready to, you know, you should be able to die before you break these vows. You cannot break these vows. But many times we talk about cruelty to animals and not eating, you know, no meat eating. But we are so much in a sleepy stage that we are very, very maybe kind to the animals, but we become extremely cruel, rude to the Vaishnavas. The whole process is supposed to make us awake to not being cruel. But because this whole transaction that we are, where we engage in, without really being awake constantly, we become very cruel to the Vaishnavas. We start gambling with the instructions of our spiritual master and the scriptures by making a very malleable, ductile, I mean malleability of the scriptures, as we call. The whole knowledge is very malleable. You can really change it the way you want, and you start gambling with these instructions. You get intoxicated with the power and position that we get. It's a serious problem, my dear friends. We have taken vow not to do this, but we do get intoxicated by position, and how much havoc it is caused, not only in the outside world with this power and position, but in our own society. We're supposed to be a society where we are awake to the fact that we are simply supposed to be witnesses and not get involved in a transaction. And we start having so much illicit relationship with the material energy in a form of various offerings of the material energy. Honestly, there is a serious epidemic that we all are face to face with. You know what is epidemic? That means it is all over. The epidemic of material energy, it was always there since time in memory. In the material world, is all about the epidemic of material energy, but it is becoming more and more intense. The heat is becoming more and more intense. It's getting boiled hotter and hotter and hotter. And we all got succumbed to this material energy in a form of cruelty to Vaishnavas, as I sometimes see myself doing and sometimes observe being done. Gambling with the instructions, intoxicated by power and position, and having illicit I mean, it's illicit means using the material energy in the form of internet, technology, and many, many other things. Not for the purpose of Krishna consciousness purely, but playing with such things which is like fire. Are we careful what we are doing? You are playing with fire, you are playing with material energy. It can burn you, it can hurt you, seriously. Are we really aware? We can be aware only if you are awake. If you are sleepy, you may touch something and get burned and not even know about it, my dear friends. And that's why the scripture, Dhamsa Avatar, Lord Krishna himself and Lord Brahma took the help of Krishna to tell us this important aspect of the need to be awake. And after being awake, to be simply a witness to what's happening. That means to detach ourselves slowly. But how can we detach ourselves? Unless and until we seriously every day are begging to Krishna to make us attached to the holy name, to the Vaishnavas and to Vaishnava Seva. If we don't attach to Krishna, that's why Mukunda Madhava Yadava Hari Bolena Bolore Bhajana Vadana Hari Miche Nidra Boshe Gelore Rati Divasa Sarira Saje. If you're not attached to chanting Mukunda Madhava Yadava and Hari, then you are going to use your day and night simply in sense gratification. These are basic principles coming back to us in the 11th canto of Bhagavatam to make us aware of the dangers of sense gratification and the need, the acute need, the serious need, the emergency need to take shelter of Krishna and to detach ourselves from sense gratification. Otherwise, we can be thinking we are doing the process, but we are getting bound more and more and more, like the cocoon. I mean, like the, what's that? Moth getting the silkworm by binding himself. It's a serious problem, and that's why let us really focus all our life. But at least for today, let us really focus on this aspect of being the witness. And very soon we are going to go to this very special place, Sakshi Gopal, witness Gopal, Prabhupada calls it. Sakshi Gopal. Krishna is the witness. And he's witnessing. How well are we witnessing the activities that are happening in outside? Or do we really get involved with their activities? So let us pray to Krishna, our spiritual master, to really help us to get detached from this very, very dangerous situation that we could really find ourselves in, of sleepiness, of being in mode of ignorance, in sleep, and not really aware of where we are, what we are. Because, you know, sometimes when you are sleepy, you don't even know where you are, what you are. And that's why these three stages I found very, very interesting for a sadhaka to understand. Jagrat, Swapna and Susupta. And then of course Turiya stage, where you are a witness. That's the stage that we want to reach. Not be in the Susupta stage, deep sleep, ignorance. Not be in the passion of dreaming, being in the dreamland, but be awake. And by being awake, to be a witness that we have nothing to do with this material world. This is not a place for a gentleman to live. This is a foreign place. We don't belong here. We finish our business the best way we can and then carry on with our journey to serve our spiritual master and serve Sri Sri Radha Gopinatha. Thank you very, very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions? Any comments? Yadubara Prabhu, please, if there's anything that you would like to add, please.
Thank you, Prabhu, for the nice class. Your intensity of purpose really comes through. We wish we all had that intensity of desire. The I once asked Devamrita Swami, when do these material desires cease? He looked at me and said, never. As long as we have these bodies and that those desires will be there, sometimes we become discouraged because the desires are quite constant, as you mentioned in your class. But we should realize that as long as we have these bodies, the force of those desires will be there. We'd actually really have to, as you mentioned also, be detached and be a witness to what's going on in the body. Another pastime about sleeping, Hansidutta Prabhu was with Prabhupada. He slept in his room. I'm not sure of the circumstances, but anyway, he was sleeping in the same room as Prabhupada, and he couldn't sleep. He was so nervous being in the same room with Prabhupada. And so Prabhupada, you know, got up as usual around 1 o'clock. And Hansidutta confided in Prabhupada, "Prabhupada, I cannot sleep." He said, and Prabhupada said, "Oh, that is very good." He said, "Actually, I don't like to sleep." And he said, "Really, our goal is no sleep." We don't say that, but the goal is no sleep. like Arjuna. Yeah. So anyway, thank you very much for your class. Hare Krishna.
And we also have, I remember her hearing from Radhanath Maharaj about Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj, that he would never ever sleep in the afternoon. He said, just enough, whatever sleep in the day, but he said, cannot sleep again in the afternoon. You know, that sleeping is a waste of time, he said. It's simply a waste of time. Of course, we need to be on that level, but that's why great souls, one of the signs of great souls is they sleep less. And of course, the next statement immediately follows, we obviously can't imitate them. But this Raghunath Das Goswami, Srila Prabhupada, and all these great persons, one of the criteria is that they sleep less. But of course, at the same time, you cannot just judge a person how great he is or how much he sleeps. This is just one of the criteria. Yeah, let's not start judging people. Oh, You sleep 10 hours, you are not great. So this is one of the criteria. Yeah. Thank you very much, Yadupra Prabhu.
Yeah, one other thing. Shyam Sundar Prabhu, after being with Prabhupada for some time, never really saw him sleeping. So he was on a train and Prabhupada looked like he was sleeping. So Shyam Sundar went up very close, you know, about this far from Prabhupada's head. I was looking at him trying to, is he sleeping or not sleeping? All of a sudden, Prabhupada's eyes just pop open and look at Shyam Sundar. What are you doing? Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki, Granth Raj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Nitai Gaur Premanandi, Hare Hare.